Hello and welcome. My name is Thomas Graf. I'm CTO and co-founder of iSurveillance, and I would like to give all of you a very warm welcome to this year's eBPF Summit. This year, I would like to take an opportunity and look ahead and talk about opportunities and challenges on eBPF's roadmap in the next couple of years. As co-founder and CTO of iSurveillance, or as iSurveillance more broadly, we have been very involved in eBPF since its creation in 2014, and we have launched and open source projects like Cilium, Tetragon, and Hubble. So overall, a lot of involvement. One could even say that a lot of our company's mission and vision was very tightly connected to eBPF. So let's look at what we see, what I see as the future roadmap of eBPF in terms of opportunities it has. If this is your first summit, or if this is the first time you have an encounter with eBPF, what is eBPF? So here is a very quick introduction, 1 minute. eBPF is an efficient and a secure virtual machine running eBPF bytecode. So look at the picture, you see assembly code that can run as part of the operating system. So think about it as a module code that can run. By doing so, it is making the operating system programmable. What's important is it can make that, or it does that by, in a very efficient and a very secure fashion. In particular, the secure aspect, highly important, as we all learned in the last couple of months, where we saw the devastating effect if a kernel extension is able to crash the operating system. So with this engine, with this virtual machine, with this runtime, able to run eBPF bytecode, an entire wave of networking, security, and observability toolings have been created, leveraging these superpowers of eBPF. And throughout this year's summit, you will hear many, many examples of what exactly is it that eBPF unlocked for them, like projects, solutions, tools that you have all created. You will hear about a very, very wide set of applications of eBPF. Besides this summit, if you are new, then I think the eBPF documentary is also a great way to get a first amount of information. The documentary available on YouTube, so you can just Google eBPF documentary or go on ebpfdocumentary.com and watch the 30-minute documentary on eBPF. It will go back in time and tell you the creation story with the people involved, how the tech giants came in, how it all worked, how we convinced the Linux kernel community to even merge eBPF. Lots of great and funny stories along the way. It's 30 minutes, but it will not feel like 30 minutes at all. Definitely a popcorn-worthy movie. Before we now look into the future, I want to take a moment to highlight what was the single most important aspect of why we even created eBPF. And for me, that is eBPF enabling rapid innovation. I think it's crucial to understand this because it really defines the future roadmap of eBPF as well. So think back, 2014, 10 years ago, Linux had just become the standard or the designated standard for the new operating system running on servers. Like many of us kernel developers, we got excited because all of a sudden, all the development times we built or we put into our hobby developing Linux, all of a sudden, this software project was destined to run on thousands, ten thousands, hundreds of thousands of servers worldwide. So a lot of popularity, a lot of success. Amazing. But it also had a downside. All of these people wanting to run Linux at scale and in highly efficient mission-critical environments obviously wanted Linux to become boring, stable, and change is a natural enemy of stability and boring. So Linux became slower and eventually slow. And what used to take days now took months, bringing a concept, a new idea, and write kernel code, getting that merged into the upstream Linux kernel and making that available for end users or for end users to even adopt these new Linux kernel versions took months, in some extreme cases, even years. And obviously, that really slowed down innovation. eBPF has fundamentally re-enabled that rapid feature development from months back to days, right? what used to take months, we could now write an eBPF program, load it dynamically, execute it securely, and all of a sudden we have extended the Linux kernel on the fly, on demand. And this really brought a wave of eBPF-based super innovation. So think about the bees carrying the snail that got slower and slower and slower, carrying tooks, like eBPF bees carrying the snail and allowing it to go really, really fast again. So that's what got us here. That was the last 10 years, and obviously that still dictates the forward direction. eBPF is amazing at enabling rapid innovation for infrastructure and for tooling at the operating system level. So looking ahead, what else is on the roadmap? What else can we use as challenges, as opportunities? The most obvious one, and probably no longer a big secret, is that eBPF is coming to Windows. So if you Google for eBPF for Windows, you will find a Git repository that has eBPF code able to run on the Windows operating system. eBPF was specifically written for Linux, and it evolved inside of the Linux kernel. The name suggests that it's coming from the BSD days, and that's accurate. There was a BPF implementation that even made it into Linux, all BSD-based. eBPF really was a new implementation from scratch and then made compatible to also run legacy BPF programs or classic BPF programs. So that Linux-specific eBPF runtime and the ecosystem is now being ported over to Windows. Now that will not look exactly the same. It will bring compatibility in terms of bytecode. So the bytecode language will be the same. It will also, of course, have a verification concept, and will have things like just-in-time compilation and so on, or once eBPF bytecode signatures are common. All of these concepts are identical and the same, but the actual hook points where eBPF programs can attach may actually be slightly different depending on the operating system. So that also means that we need to bring the existing tooling that we have done, eBPF-based tooling, written for Linux, and also port that over to Windows. So that's exciting. It gives us more reach. All the tooling we have developed for Linux, they will become available or can be made available on Windows over the coming years, and that will keep many of us busy from that front. That's exciting. Lots of reach. That popularity, that additional success, obviously also comes at a particular cost. So that means that as an eBPF ecosystem, we have to ensure that all the tools we're writing are compatible, right? End users do not want to think about whether one tool is compatible to another one, or I can only use tool A but not with tool B, and so on. Tools will need to be compatible. Like many, many tools are coming to the market or are published or open sourced every year based on eBPF. Amazing. All of you have so many great ideas that you implement. These tools often then rely on the same hook points, or they implement even the same ideas. We need to come together and make sure that these tools become compatible, and we solve the problem of interoperability or compatibility. You can also see that there is OSS code will continue to be the standardizing body on the slide here. What do I mean by that? By that, I mean that eBPF is a classic example where we didn't write the standard specification first and then implemented code. We actually did the opposite, the reverse. We evolved eBPF as an open source project as part of the kernel, and the code became the standard. We're now standardizing eBPF, or eBPF is being standardized as part of the IETF, but it's based on the open source code. And the open source code will remain to be the source of truth, where the actual standard is evolving, where we have the discussions and the consensus finding. That will not change, right? So, But that means as a community, we have to come together, figure out how do we make tools compatible to each other? How do we make tools portable from one operating system to the next? So exciting. That's a bit of a challenge. We need to solve this. It's something to unlock for the next wave of eBPF tooling. It's a cost of the success of eBPF. If you look a little bit further, what else is on the horizon? And one topic is very obvious. AI, and I'll put an asterisk right there, right? Because I don't necessarily mean that we need to use AI for eBPF. If you have ideas and you want to explore that, go for it. I think it can be very exciting. But there is even just a broader industry I would say, movement that is that will happen completely disconnected to how successful AI will be. There's currently a large investment into GPUs and DPUs, and you can see that when you look at the NVIDIA stock for sure, right? So instead of just deploying CPUs, companies around the world are now also deploying GPUs, graphical processing units, and DPUs, data processing units, specifically to enable AI workloads in the future. And this investment is happening, and it is happening completely disconnected from the fact whether the AI wave will actually produce something really, really meaningful or not. The opportunity is so big that the industry will try. So this will happen. It will result in an entire new wave of infrastructure getting deployed that is not just CPUs anymore, but is more specialized hardware with GPUs and DPUs. And that new infrastructure layer with more capabilities will drive demand for rapid innovation in that infrastructure. So all the goodness that eBPF brought for the age of CPU only will need to get reapplied for the age of CPU plus GPU plus DPU. And this is where eBPF will be able to come in and again, illustrate and demonstrate its superpowers applied to GPUs and DPUs. Last but not least, the outlook that keeps me most excited is what I call eBPF distributed intelligence, which is a completely made up word. I don't think that's an official term in any way, but think about it this way. So far, any sort of intelligent behavior or analytics or even machine learning use case, anytime we try to apply some smartness, the typical architecture we have been using so far is we have compute with applications running, infrastructure running, and then we have relatively dumb data collectors that will stream a lot of observability or telemetry to an analytics database. This can be an SIM, can be a time series database, it can be a graph database, whatever it is. A lot of data gets streamed into these databases and we keep a record of the history, and then we look at that data. And we make decisions based on that data. We run analytics or we learn, right? That's the model that's been dominant so far. And it's a model that works, but it will eventually stop scaling because it results in a massive amount of data being needed to be transferred. And it has massive storage requirements as well. And we're now at the point where the amount of intelligence that can be applied is limited by your budget for data transfer and storage requirements, or just the scaling abilities of databases. Well, what if we could turn this around and we can say, instead of bringing the data to the intelligence, we bring the intelligence to the data? So think as eBPF as giving us the opportunity to not just have very deep observability, but to also essentially only extract the observability we need and then apply logic to make intelligent decisions and react to that. Ways that don't require us to stream data somewhere else and then react there, but to essentially make a decision, an intelligent, smart decision on the fly based on the context we have available at where the source of the data actually lies. This will not work for all types of use cases. There will be use cases that do require this completely distributed view over observability samples from all sorts of edge nodes and then so on. But for a lot of use cases, bringing the intelligence to this data will be way more efficient. It will lead to new security, networking, observability monitoring tools that are more efficient, have faster reaction times, and in the end result in better infrastructure for all users. So that's what keeps me very excited for the next coming years. I think this will be an area where eBPF will really shine and where we will see not just rapid innovation, but also application of eBPF's logic ability. And with that, I would like to say I'm really looking forward to continue innovating with all of you. I would love for you all to reach out to me, ping me on Slack, ping me on LinkedIn. I would love to hear, are you agreeing? Are you disagreeing? What are you excited about? What keeps you excited about eBPF? What are ideas you have? I would love to learn from you and continue the conversation. With that, I would like to thank you all very much and want to wish you a continued successful, funny eBPF summit. And I'm looking forward to answering questions on Slack. Thank you very much.